Welcome to the world of wolves. At the Camperdown Wildlife Centre, where over the next 20 minutes, I'll give you some insider knowledge on how the wolves operate and what it takes to accommodate them. I'm your host, James Christie. So let us begin by stating captive wolves will function within a pack that is comprised of family members. Here at Camperdown, we have one alpha male named Loki, which is the father of four sons. One son, which takes after his dad from both features and nature. His name is Bear. Out of the wolves, these two are the most dominant. And if Bear was in the wild, he'd venture out and form a new pack as the next alpha. There are three submissive wolves. One is named James, who is the most inquisitive and most likely to come and say hello. Fenrir, but most of all, Frank, the skittish one. Wolves have a strict social hierarchy that they learn from when they are puppies and enforce through their entire life from the most dominant animal. In this case, it is their father, Loki. The documentary will show these behaviours firsthand, from their job roles to dominant and submissive gestures that helps to make the pack run effectively and healthy without conflict or injuries. But before diving into the interesting aspects of the social dynamics, let's talk about how the enclosure and welfare is run. All zoos must adhere to safety and legislation from organisation and laws, one of which is the World Association of Zoos and Aquariums, otherly known as WASA. The mission of WASA is to provide leadership and support for zoos, aquariums and partner organisations of the world in animal care and welfare. It is also responsible for conservation of biodiversity, environmental education and global sustainability. Another of which is EASA, formed in 1992 with a mission to facilitate cooperation within the European zoo and aquarium communities towards the goals of education, research and conservation. As well as educational purposes, it provides funding and manpower to projects protecting animal populations and their habitats. By researching all aspects of animal biology, this improves our understanding on how they live and interact to best provide a higher quality of life in captivity. This is achieved by ensuring that member zoos and aquariums maintain the highest standards of care and breeding for the species they keep. EASA empowers European citizens to learn about and contribute to global biodiversity conservation goals. The final organisation is BIASA, the British and Irish Association of Zoos and Aquariums. BIASA is a member of both WASA and EASA, and through this network, members collaborate on a global scale to provide further conservation science, natural history and environmental education for animal welfare. As well as having organisations in support of the animal welfare, there are laws that enforce both public and animal safety. These are called the Zoo Licensing Act of 1981 and the Dangerous Wild Animal Act of 1976, which both require a licence from the local authority in order for safety and welfare to be achieved and maintained. The legislation, the laws, the organisations all enforce the ways in which a habitat is run, which mostly refers to the five freedoms. The five freedoms are the internationally accepted standards of care, that all animals under our care must be upheld to a high standard of living and humane treatment. Developed from the Britain's Farm Animal Welfare Council in 1965, and evolved since to meet the needs of every individual type of animal there is. The five freedoms ensure we meet the mental and physical needs of an animal in our care. Freedom from hunger and thirst by ready access to fresh water and diet to maintain health and vigour. This must be specific to the animal. Freedom from discomfort by providing an appropriate shelter away from the elements and the comfortable resting area. With the correct substrate and temperature control, managed noise levels and access to natural light, all determined by the species of animal. Above all, the ability to stretch their legs and run around with the enclosure cleaned and maintained regularly. Freedom from pain, injury or disease by prevention or rapid diagnosis and treatment. Therefore, regular monitoring and health checks are required. This includes vaccinating, ensuring strong physical health through diet and exercise, treating any injuries and providing appropriate medication. Freedom to express normal behaviours by providing sufficient space, proper facilities and the companionship of animals of their own kind. Providing plenty environmental enrichment to mimic their natural habitat. This has changed to suit the needs of each individual species of animal. With the mental stimulation to help complement their natural behaviours. And lastly, freedom from fear and distress. The mental health of the animal is just as important as the physical, as psychological stress can quickly turn it into physical illness. This is shown through uncharacteristic behaviours such as over-grooming, no appetite, aggression towards peers, or self-harm. It is prevented by not overcrowding and with plenty of places to hide to feel safe, free from stress such as noise and predators. Although wolves have the potential to be omnivores, eating both meat and vegetables, they stick to a purely carnivorous diet because unlike our domesticated canines, the wolf's digestive tract is 20 times more sensitive. There are cases where they eat grass to settle an upset stomach. However, this doesn't get supplemented or added into their diet, as meat is far more accepted and nutritional. In the wild, wolves would eat a wide variety of animals, from small to big, gained from foraging for critters and dead animals that is left behind by other predators, or gained through the hunt with the pack. Nothing will be wasted because they will eat the hooves, bones and horns for calcium, as well as for mental stimulus, enjoying every inch of the animal. In the wild, they do not always eat every day due to the availability of prey. Therefore, they will engorge on a kill of up to 22.5 pounds in a single day, as they may have to go without food for days on end. To mimic this, starve days are implemented in captivity, rotating the days between getting carcasses, scatter feeding critters, and starve days, in order to prevent pre-feeding anticipation and complement natural behaviours shown in the wild. Legislation dictates that no live vertebrate is to be fed to an animal. Therefore, stimulating their prey drive is next to impossible in captivity. Therefore, scatter feeding to enrich foraging behaviours is a vital way of feeding the wolves, providing mental stimulation for them using their senses. A carcass is prepared, deboned, skinned and beheaded, removing the brain. It can be kept frozen for up to 4 days, and then it's defrosted, served with vitamin powder on the same day. Footage shows the typical rota for the feeding schedule, as well as presentation of the meats, with the keeper Katrina preparing the meals and Phil distributing them. In a normal week at Camperdown, the 5 wolves will get 2 carcasses, with another added during winter, 30 quail, 24 rats, 26 chicks, and a few hares scatterfed. As well as beef, mince and bones. However, other than the carcasses, this is not considered a key part of their diet, but mostly to enrich them, with something to do and forage for, providing stimulus through the use of their senses. As you can tell by now, that is a lot of meat and a lot of dead animals in order to feed the wolves. Therefore, Camperdown has a license to purchase dead animals through outside sources, such as gamekeepers, at a discount. All assuming they are acquired humanely with headshots. You could even purchase your passed on pet if handed in and preserved. As well as feeding and maintaining a healthy natural diet, the other roles of a zookeeper is, well, all that food has to go somewhere, so cleaning and maintaining the enclosure is of great importance, removing waste daily, checking the enclosure and repairing where is needed, such as a breach in the fence or a damaged enrichment, providing new enrichment to stimulate the animal, and honouring the 5 freedoms. Whilst the keepers are in the enclosure, the wolves will migrate to the other side,
away from viewing eyes but still keeping a close eye on what the keepers are doing, giving them plenty of room to either remove waste or to add food. This is done as quick as possible in order not to stress the wolves out. This is often followed by 5 to 10 perimeter checks from the wolves before becoming settled and confident to take the food or rest. The wolves, just like our dogs, will communicate using body language, scents and vocalisation. However, these and ritualistic behaviours are enforced more strongly within a pack of wolves, which they learn from siblings when they are pups, tested and used frequently throughout their life. This will maintain a strict social hierarchy within a pack that can result in prevention of injury and death during conflict. This is due to submissive and dominant gestures. They can mimic a fight without causing any harm, however through play the chain of command from strongest to weakest is formed. Therefore it often won't escalate further than a second or two, causing no damage despite how it looks. In cases where ritualistic behaviours fails, it's when a wolf from an outside source is introduced, disrupting the chain of command, which can be fatal, as well as a dominant family member reaches maturity and rivals dominance with the previous alpha mating pair. This was the result of the females in Camperdown proving fatal. Normally in the wild, they will leave and form a new pack of their own. However, in captivity, options are limited. However, this is very rare. Often all conflicts, such as who eats first, causing aggression, will be solved by a dominant display, such as baring teeth, raised heckles, growling, and then snapping the ear, or pinning to the ground. In reverse, it doesn't escalate due to pacifying gestures, such as lip smacking, pinned back ears with a curled tail, avoidance of eye contact, and whimpering. They're all practiced throughout their life, even through grooming. The submissive one will show friendliness to the dominant and lick their lips for permission. This is another pacifying gesture. All of their findings from their daily routines, the keepers will record everything in logbooks that is shared by other zoos for research purposes. These are called stud books, uploaded to ZIMS, which is the Zoological Information Management System, that will replace the current ISIS software to provide a more accurate and comprehensive database for animal inventories. More than 500 animal care experts from zoos, aquariums and related organisations worldwide will participate in the project, providing information that is accessible to all. In order to achieve this, there are two types of stud books that is linked and work towards the goals of EASA. They are called the EEP, that focuses on the research of the species for which to breed or not, and the ESB, that collects data on births, deaths and transfers. These are useful for zoos in collaboration for things like breeding programs and for better care of life. These findings are also useful for understanding the species to help mimic their habitat, providing natural environmental enrichment. Some examples of good welfare are: the keeper's knowledge is up to date, the five freedoms is being honoured, the correct substrate, the correct enrichment and the correct enclosure size, regular observations. With a nutritional healthy diet and a medical professional that is on call, the with plenty of enrichment to stimulate the animal's natural behaviours. These are but some requirements of good welfare. However, not all zoos achieve this, so next time you're at one, keep your eyes out for some of these bad points of welfare, which are
overcrowding and small enclosures that's not maintained, bad hygiene with waste that's spoiling. This will cause disease and infection. The condition of the animals. Are they bored? Are they looking skinny? That can be a result of no enrichment and poor diet. Placing predators beside prey. You have to remember their location. This will result in stress, causing uncharacteristic behaviours. These are but some examples of poor welfare. Therefore, a picture of a healthy enclosure from the Five Freedoms and Welfare should come into mind. So with that in mind, let's look at the wolves' enclosure. The enclosure is sectioned off into three areas that is double fenced with an electric wire running around its perimeter for public safety. The main area has a large platform for resting and where food is distributed. A side area for hiding away from viewing eyes to cause less stress to the animals, as dictated in the Five Freedoms, as well as a walkway to sheltered resting area, away from the elements, altogether larger than 2 football fields long. Within the enclosure, it has an abundance of long, fresh grass, large logs and trees for environmental enrichment that mimics a natural habitat in the wild. Keepers are regularly clean to remove waste and repair any damages to the enclosure. Normally, the keepers would include enrichments into the enclosure, such as toys, obstacles and chews. However, due to a misunderstanding in previous years with the females that they once had, they have been hesitant to add new things in due to fear of distress, resulting in simplifying their enrichment to scatter feeding. However, after years of good welfare, the keepers believe that the 5 males are ready for new stimulations that can be added in. Therefore, I am the first student to attempt this, so I plan on adding a few small enrichments in to see what gives the best results. Whilst doing my research on these 5, I monitor certain behaviours and how frequently they do them over the 3 months. The ethograms were an hour long with 10 minute intervals in all types of weather, showing the behaviours: resting, feeding, food aggression, dominant displays, submissive displays, bonding, grooming, perimeter checks, coordination, solitary behaviours, job role changes, and unsettled behaviour. I learned from this which was the most dominant and which was the most submissive wolf, as well as how they act around food and human involvement, learning how often they check the perimeter and how often they become unsettled. All to provide the best conditions for success on installing the enrichments. I found that it was the same wolf that was unsettled and nervous all the time. However, the keepers say that for the pack to run smoothly and healthy, this must be the case, that one lone member of the pack must stay on lookout. I tested various sounds and frequencies, from elk cries, wolf howls, to low pitch and high, resulting in minimal results. Except during the high pitch, all the wolves checked the entrance where the keepers enter, which tells me they were using a whistle at feeding times, resulting in using a different sensory other than hearing for the enrichment. Therefore, my hypothesis for the enrichment is this. For physical enrichment, I will add a tug-of-war toy connected to a tree to prevent possessiveness and aggression, coloured blue and yellow to attract them visually, as they are on the wolf's spectrum. Scented with a prey animal for a week to encourage play and increase the confidence of the unsettled wolf. Also add a food basket atop of the resting frame with chicks, hay and fur in it. This can be turned into hanging a carcass for them to rip apart.
I see bad.
Lastly, I plan to complement their sense of smell and foraging behaviour with food bags scattered throughout their enclosure, coloured blue and yellow, filled with beef and mince, scented with blood-dipped feathers, fur from dogs, and a shedded snake skin. However, in conclusion, after viewing the hunting camera, due to neophobic behaviours from the wolves, they were far too wary of the physical enrichments, causing an increase of unsettled behaviour and perimeter checks. But the scented food bags were a success, resulting that foraging is the best way to go. There were also some uncharacteristic behaviours shown, such as overly cautiousness, patrolling the set area every 5 minutes, pre-feeding anticipation, and taking 45 minutes to 2 hours before gaining the courage to go for food. An interesting set of behaviours, all stemming from the acceptance of the alpha. The others will patrol and sniff out the food, but leave it untouched until Dad deems it is safe. He will stay in the background and approach when he is ready. I would like to say what a pleasure it has been studying and interacting with each species of animal Camperdown Wildlife Centre has to offer, getting to know their needs, natures, instincts and personalities to help better enrich their lives. Above all, the comparison of the ritualistic behaviours between wolves and canines, a personal interest of mine, compared with my Akita. In my series, I had an opportunity to help other students with their enrichment, as well as giving the goats a brand new platform and ramp to play on. So with that in mind, a special thanks to the lecturers for their support and my fellow classmates for the inspiration, a most positive and welcoming bunch. I'm your host, James Christie, and thanks for watching.